Look at verse 25 once more. At midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. You see, when we talk about their witness, it's grounded in their relationship with God. That's who they're praying to. That's who they're singing to. The fact that the other prisoners are hearing them is just an aside. They're not praying to be heard by the other prisoners. Jesus called those type of people hypocrites. They're praying to God. Their witness shows itself in their desire to be like Christ and to worship Him and glorify Him. And that's how our witness will show itself. That is the witness that those who come in contact with us will pay attention to far more readily than the words that come out of our mouth. They're going to watch our lives. They're going to see, do you live like Christ lived? Do you love like Him? Do you forgive like Him? Are you gracious like Him? Are you holy like Him? But having said that, as important as our personal life witness is, let's not make the mistake that I have heard the occasional Christian over the years say, well, I witness for Jesus with my life. Well, that's good. We all should. But nobody is ever going to get saved and be in heaven simply by watching your Christian lifestyle, no matter how good it is. The Bible is very clear on this. You have to first hear and then believe the gospel to be saved. And how will they believe unless they have heard? And so what your life will do, your life testimony will set the stage, will turn to you for a testimony. And that's what happens right here. And now they understand the purpose for their sufferings, the purpose for their imprisonment. Verse 29, then he, the jailer, called for a light, ran in, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas, and he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? So they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes. And immediately he and all his family were baptized. Now when he had brought them into his house, he set food before them. And he rejoiced, having believed in God with all his household. Maybe his question was prompted by the background of this whole case. Hearing about them casting out this demon and this girl who was going around saying, these are the ones who will show you the way to salvation. Maybe that's why it was in his mind. We don't know. But it is a very emphatic, definite request. He's saying, what must I do? What is it necessary for me to do for the purpose, in order, for me to be saved? Here's a man that just moments before was about to commit suicide. He was filled with fear and desperate. Most suicides are because of fear of the future, which leads to a present desperation. Maybe the future is going to be filled with pain because of some horrible disease, and you know it's going to be horrible, and it leads you to a desperate situation now. Or maybe the future is filled with scandal and shame because you've been caught doing something, and you just can't imagine living the rest of your life. So fear, though, leads to a present desperation. That's exactly where this guy was. There was an atheistic philosopher some time ago who said, of all the questions that mankind wrestles with, there's really only one that matters. And that question is whether or not a man should commit suicide or not. That's the philosophy of the atheist. And he's right. You see, if life has no meaning and no purpose, because there is no God, and we all know from the time we're little children we're going to die someday anyway, we all know that, then why not do what is inevitable anyway and do it now? Get it over with. Why go through the hardships of life? Why work? Why? What for? That was his perspective as an atheist. Evolution is an atheistic teaching. Don't let anyone ever tell you anything different. The evolutionist believes in atheism, believes that all that exists, all of life, including all of us, happens to exist purely by accident. Now, sometimes people want to decorate that a little bit. And they talk about the, you know, a little bit of design or whatever, but the evolutionists say, no, it's accidental circumstances, mutations and all. That's why we're here. You can't start bringing in some sort of a mind, some sort of a design, some sort of a power, some sort of a will. You cannot do that under evolutionary teaching. You cannot. Now, they say, you go be religious all you want. You know, if you want something to do on Sundays or whatever, that's fine. But it has nothing to do with evolution. And they laugh at the Christians who try to somehow combine God and theistic evolution, all that. Because the evolutionist says, no, it's ridiculous. It's not what evolution teaches. Now, the thing is, most people believe in evolution. And yet, most people do not live as if they believe in evolution. Because most people will say, it is certainly wrong to selfishly hurt someone else, take advantage of them. That's wrong. Why is it wrong? If I'm stronger than you, I'm smarter than you, in other words, I'm more fit than you, survival of the fittest. Don't start talking about issues like wrong and right and getting into some moral discussion when we're talking about evolution. The strong survive. Why can't I, if I can get away with it, if I'm stronger than you and show it? Now, the answer will come back, well, wait a minute, you're making a mistake. You're focusing so much on the individual, you're forgetting the whole species. See, hypothetically, if you went and took a machine gun and gunned everyone down except you, well, then the species would die because you'd be the only one left and you would die out too. So what has happened is this whole sense of right and wrong, where we come to this social contract, this agreement that we're going to not take advantage of each other to each other's hurt. That's something that has evolved. Again, there's no morality to that. There's no God involved in that. It is something that has evolved. It's this chemical process in our whole makeup, just like your thumb has evolved, for the betterment of the species. We've discovered through evolution that the reason we think this way and believe this way is because we recognize that this is the way the species will continue to advance as a species. But I got to throw the penalty flag on that one too. Because again, we don't live that way. Because now, if it's not about the individual, it's about the species. Tell me then, why do we not eliminate or at the least sterilize all who are born with genetic defects that lead to disease and handicaps? What good for the species is it for them to reproduce? That's going to hurt the species. We need to eliminate them. Make sure they don't breed. If what's good for the species is what it's all about. And we're told on a daily basis about our natural resources being limited. They're running out. This earth is too populated, we're told. Why don't we eliminate all the elderly who don't reproduce anymore? They're no good anymore for the species. Why don't we eliminate all of the homosexuals who can't reproduce? If the goal of the species and evolution of the species is the purpose, why don't we do these things? Because it's wrong to do those things.